Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
This is David Dubal, and I am very pleased to have in WNCN's magnificent studios two magnificent women who are magnificent pianists, and they play all over the world together, and they're just here for, well, they love America, and they play constantly here. They had a tour of like 40, 50 cities. Is that right, or was it 20 cities?
Yeah, it's going to be 2 months tour, and we're playing almost every day.
Now, we want to get back to my introduction because you are Katia, and
yes,
you are, we're on television, Marielle Labèque. And they were born in not Bayonne, New Jersey, but Bayonne, France. And they don't have English accents or American accents. They are truly French pianists from the great tradition stemming from Marguerite Long, and your mother studied with Marguerite.
Yes, she was a pupil of Marguerite Long.
Tell me of your beginnings, your roots as pianists.
Oh, I start very young. I was three, and like everybody, I gave my first concert. I was seven in the Théâtre des Champs-Élysées in Paris. And Marielle started, she was five. And Mam taught us for a long time. She was our teacher before we went in the Paris Conservatory. And then we went out the same year with the first prize. And after we start to play together in concert, like professionally, from 68.
Mm-hmm. So you've been playing together a great deal of time now.
Yes,
so
now 14 years, like professionally. Mm-hmm. But we always try to play together before.
We were obviously child prodigies because you're both very young.
Yes, I don't like so much the name of child prodigy. I thought it was just natural. Mom was a pianist and the piano was here, and I thought everybody had a piano. You know, I was surprised when I walked into another house and no piano. I thought people was a little normal.
Uh-huh. Marielle, did you, as the younger of the sisters, did you also think that that was the bread and butter of your life, that the piano was just an automatic thing that happened?
I didn't.
C'était quelque chose de si naturel.
Yes, for me, were the same because Katia was playing and before me, mm-hmm. and I wanted to do the same thing. And my mother was playing, and everybody, because she teach even now. Mm-hmm. She has a lot of pupils, and the music was every day at home.
Yeah, all over the house.
Now, what about solo careers? You're now very linked together, and your record of Gershwin, in which we'll hear mm-hmm. both the Rhapsody in Blue and a movement from the Great Concerto today on this program, you're linked together. Did you ever feel resentful, let's say, oh, I want to leave Marielle or Katia and I want to go on my own?
No, that's true. The question could happen or could be asked. The thing is, we're not doing only that. Marielle is playing a lot of chamber music with violinist or cello. She played with Dick Stolzman, the clarinet player.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And also we play chamber music in France with Augustin Dumay, which is a violin player, or Lynn Harrell, the mm-hmm. cellist. And so she does that a little bit more than I do. Mm-hmm. And let's say that I do a little more jazz or 20th century music. Mm-hmm. But not in solos, because I don't feel like it's my kind of expression. I love to share music,
really?
And to be with other musicians. I think it's a way to make you become richer, mm-hmm. because everybody bring you something. And especially when you start with some other fields, you don't know anything. Like when I started in jazz, it was 5-6 years ago, and I really didn't know anything about that. And I couldn't even understand the way they were doing to improvise on chords. So, and I think that's helped me a lot with the rhythm. And for music like Gershwin or Stravinsky or Bartok, I think it's a big help.
Now, you played in New York, your Gershwin, and also Stravinsky. Mm-hmm. What about the two piano literature? I'll ask you two questions. you're playing in many universities and many places. Is there a difficulty ever in some places getting to good pianos that match up?
Yeah, that's very difficult.
That's a thorn in one's...
Yeah, that's a big problem almost everywhere, not only in America. In America, of course, there is a problem with American Steinway, which are really different of Hamburg Steinway, the one where we used to play. But still, that's really the one I prefer to play. I mean, I
Hamburg?
Feel, yeah, I think so. But Steinway, in any case, that's a piano we prefer to play.
More in Europe, we can find very easy now. Mm-hmm. In Germany, and it's so easy. Mm-hmm. Steinway and all.
Are you all both over. Satisfied the way your careers are going? I know that the Phillips album, which we'll be hearing, and it is just wonderful, has sold amazingly well for classical
you
music.
You know, I wouldn't think of myself or self in terms of career. As long as we're playing the music we love, as long as we're... Like, I think I still need to explore some other fields, some other music, even the one. Then I'm happy. Mm-hmm. I'm happy with what I'm doing. Because that's the only way I'm looking for, is the way of the music. Mm-hmm. The only thing I really care for the moment. We didn't know Gershwin was going to sell that much. I mean, in France, it was totally unexpected. Really? I mean, for ourselves, we didn't really plan that. But the music is beautiful. It's just so universal. I mean...
You know, we're going to start our program, Katia and Marielle, with the adagio from the Concerto in F Major, which is well known in America, not like the Rhapsody in Blue, but it is some of the most beautiful music. Was this concerto not really known in France?
Not even in America, the version for two piano.
That's
Ira Gershwin wrote to us, and was a very great pleasure for us, because, I mean, he apparently loves the record, and he told us it was the first time he could hear the version of Concerto in F for
Who
two piano.
Who said this? I'm sorry.
Ira Gershwin.
Aha, uh-huh, yes. The brother.
Yes, the brother. Mm-hmm. And he said that nobody recorded before.
That's right.
And he never heard this version so much. And it's too bad, because it's a beautiful version. Gershwin is wonderful for two piano because it has a lot of rhythm. Mm-hmm. And in the music for two piano, I think it's very important. If not, that could sound sometimes heavy.
Yeah.
You know, has to have rhythmical construction. And that's why this concerto is really wonderful to play. Exciting.
Absolutely. And we're going to hear that lovely, and it's a wonderful adagio movement. Gershwin himself was an excellent pianist, as you must know.
Beautiful, oh yeah.
And he played very elegantly, not at all soupy, as many people sometimes play Gershwin. He was a very, almost a percussive pianist. And it's almost amazing to think that Gershwin died at the age of 38, something like 1900.
Yeah, that's really amazing. And with everything he wrote, that's really amazing. But I think that we heard a lot his playing, and he was very helpful for us. Mm-hmm. Because it's true, he doesn't play this soapy way. And he played with his background, which I think was classical in a way, but also a lot of ragtime and blues.
Yes.
And this kind of mixture is really obvious in his work.
Yeah.
And that's what we learn about him.
Well, we're going to hear the two piano version, which is so little known, as you say, not only in France, but here also. And it's going to happen within seconds. Here we go. And the artists, Katia and Marielle Labèque, obviously sisters. And they're smiling because here comes their record, which is a great hit in France and now is a great hit in America. Here we go. the concerto in F, the middle movement, played by my guests, Katia and Marielle Labèque, and it was just beautiful. If you would permit me to make a little break here for James Pinkney to come in with some commercials. We'll be right back. This is David Dubal, and my guests today are Katia and Marielle Labèque, duo pianists who have come from France and who have now played all over the world. Have you played in Japan yet?
No, we start in next year. That's the only thing we miss.
Because they're going to adore you. The Japanese will just absolutely keep you there, I think.
Yes.
And if you play the Gershwin Concerto like that, without a doubt. Now, I ask you another question about repertory. We were talking while we were listening to the performance, and how do you make up your programs? Is it difficult to learn two piano repertory or to find the proper music, especially in the romantic?
Yes, now we know about the repertory, and it's true that in romantic repertory, we miss a really great piece, we miss a great concerto. We don't have so many repertory with orchestra. Also, no. It's true. I mean, we have one Mozart concerto, Poulenc.
Yeah, beautiful, that Poulenc. Oh,
yeah.
You must record that. Will you be doing that soon?
I hope so. Yeah,
good.
I hope. And also Saint-Saëns we have, but it's more like, 20th century music. We don't have so much in 19th century. So we're looking now to find some list, but it's for duet,
yes,
not with orchestra. And we heard about a lot of pieces, but it's still very hard to get the score.
Mm-hmm.
I heard about something in Budapest, but we have to get them.
Now, I'm going to ask you, you're both young pianists, but you come from the French tradition of piano playing. Your mother studied with one of the quintessential figures of French pianism, Marguerite Long. Do you have any knowledge of her yourself, or did your mother say anything of interest, or about Magda Taliaferro, or about the wonderful Cortot, who was one of the
pianists? Actually, I met Marguerite Long because when I was 10, she picked up some kids to make a concert, like a birthday for Chopin, and I play. And after, it was just a really far away memories, mm-hmm. No, I think my mother was a beautiful teacher,
mm-hmm.
but it's something you can't, I don't know if myself I would be a good teacher, but I wouldn't speak today about a school in France.
Mm-hmm.
I think we have really young, wonderful pianist in France. A lot, if you compare to the other country in Europe. I mean, I don't know if they have that much that we have, like mm-hmm. Michel Béroff, Jean-Philippe Collat, Jean-Bernard mm-hmm. Pommier. I mean, there is really
quite a few important pianists.
Yes, but it's not a school. They're all coming from different teachers. I think that this big school with Marguerite Long, Cortot,
mm-hmm.
We've lost that.
We have an international kind of style.
Yes,
now,
maybe
right?
I would say I've learned much more with 4 hours with Alfred Brendel.
You worked with Brendel, both of you.
Yeah,
yes, great pianist.
It's such
wonderful.
A beautiful musician.
Mm-hmm. Musician.
Yeah. But I would say that I've learned much more with him, like in 4 hours, than in 3 years in the Paris Conservatory.
Really,
I don't keep really good memory.
We worked also with Luciano Berio because he worked for us. For a piece for two piano and two piano and percussion, and also with Pierre Boulez, and it's really important. Really.
They're epical musicians.
Yeah, to be able to speak with the composers is a big help.
Mm-hmm.
If we could work with Stravinsky now, Bartok.
Phone to Bartok and mm-hmm. say, what's about that?
You do the Rite of Spring and the two piano?
No, we do Petrushka mm-hmm. on two piano, but still we haven't done. I'm wondering about the Rite of Spring. I think it's very interesting.
At home.
Mm-hmm. At home, maybe.
Now, can you imagine the Berio selling, because this record is a gold record, meaning like you are now in the world of the rock and rollers. I mean, very few classical records have sold as well as your Gershwin two piano record. And can you imagine a Berio work selling as much as this?
Maybe one day.
One day.
Maybe one day.
Why not?
So you're optimistic people about yes. modern music. You love and care for contemporary music, don't you?
We play also a lot Messiaen, Les Visions de la Mer. We did a lot contemporary music. And We like that.
And do audiences respond well?
Yes, when they come, they respond. Yes, voilà. But sometimes when they see contemporary music, they say, oh God, and then they're a little bit afraid.
Right.
But things are working. I mean, in France especially now, they're doing a lot for contemporary.
And Boulez,
I think now the public change a lot now. A lot of young people, and it's important for the new music.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, maybe what the experiment we've done with John McLaughlin, it's a little bit in this way.
Because I think we must change the public sometimes, because we play also always dis-le-toi.
All right, then I continue. But sometimes she wants to express, but she misses the words.
I need 1 hour.
No, I think that if you want to play a new repertory, also sometimes you need a new audience.
Yeah.
Because you know the people, they love so much Mozart, Beethoven. They're not really ready. Even Bartok Stravinsky, sometimes it's look a little bit too contemporary.
Yeah.
But the experiment we have, like people who came much more for John McLaughlin, because the name he has here, and then they heard Stravinsky, they say, oh, that's rolling. You know, and finally, it's the music, they liked it. But they weren't prepared to that, you know? And they have really new ears for this kind of music. Or Messiaen, for example, who used some chords really close of Michael Tyner, some great jazz pianist.
Yes,
you know?
Oh, Messiaen is a wonderful composer.
Yes. And he can get another audience, maybe, if he's not always played just in front of classic audience.
In France, is the piano a popular instrument?
Oh, yes.
Do children still have to play it as part of their education?
Yes, this way, but it's a beautiful instrument, you know, piano.
Sure is.
Of course, I love it.
Yes.
But no, I think it's a very popular instrument. It's a complete instrument.
What happened to the French piano industry? No longer are there Pleyels and Erards?
That's crazy, because it's hard to understand what's happened. Before the war, they were still like the high of the market. Mm. And now, I shouldn't say that, but really they're not competitive at all with Stanley or even some other mark, you know?
How do you feel about America's musical audiences, or just American life in general? Is it fascinating to both of you?
Yes, America is, in any case, really fascinating.
Are you going to end up moving here?
I don't know, but it's that's interesting.
Yeah.
Because so many things are possible. I mean, you feel like, you know, a lot of possibility.
My guests today are Katia and Marielle Labèque, and we're hearing them play and talk, and they're talking very well in English. And we're going to be right back after these messages. This is David Dubal. My guests today, Katia Kabanova is an opera, by the way, by Janáček. You know that?
Yes.
Okay. And Marielle. Now, both of you looked, I thought, like twins, but one is older, but now I've forgotten which one. But it doesn't matter. These are not exactly important questions. Are you, do you ever have any trouble in the sense of career because you are women? Has that ever...
No, I wouldn't say that. I know. Sometimes it helps and sometimes it doesn't help. It's that the opposite, but it's a kind of mixture, you know. Sometimes it doesn't help for not really important things. Like, for example, you arrive in a theater, you know, and you ask the man for the light to come and to make a special kind of light. And you say, but, you know, I've been working for 30 years. I always do
that. Same with the children.
Then, you know, it's a little bit when they... It's hard if you have a kind of authority. It's a little bit hard, but it's not really important problem. That's little details, you know.
Was it exciting for you to play in Carnegie Hall's great stage?
Yes.
Yeah. And when you traveled to Los Angeles, you played with Mehta, right?
Yes, it was last...
What concerto was that?
Bartok.
Aha.
Bought a concerto for two piano and percussion and big orchestra, and it was really such a great pleasure, because Mehta is not only a beautiful conductor, wonderful musician, but he's so generous.
Mm-hmm.
And the person he is in life, I think, is the same with the music, and that helps.
What is the greatest hall you've played in so far? Is it Carnegie? Is it the Concertgebouw?
No, I think it's Music Center.
Mm-hmm.
It's like almost 4,000.
Oh, you're this summer.
Yeah, but it's not a hall. No. I mean, like a hall, closed hall.
No, the hall itself. Oh, acoustics.
I think it's Hollywood Bowl, which is almost 20,000.
Oh, that's the biggest. Yeah. But what's the best for music?
Berlin.
Berlin.
At the same time.
You never thought of this before until now? You just
No, maybe Berlin's Carnegie also, because it's so, you have so much in mind when you walk on stage, because Carnegie Hall, especially in Europe, you know, yes, Carnegie Hall, you know, you really...
Rachmaninoff played there, Schnabel played there.
Gershwin.
Gershwin played,
You know, then it's so much story about that.
Did you hear
that.
The Oscar Levant performance of the concerto before you studied it?
No, I heard about that. I heard after, but not before. So.
Now, I'll ask you a question. Are you going to, I know Peter Clancy is here with you and he wants you to record constantly because there's nothing like you two for Philips. And I know that the Philips record will be hearing, by the way. This is for you, Peter, because I know you want to sell these and I tell you it's fantastic. This is a Philips 9500-917 if you want it. Now, tell me about a new record, which is Hungarian Dances of Brahms. We don't hear those anymore, you know?
Yes.
That's right.
It's too bad because it's
beautiful,
I think,
music.
Nice music. And it's not, I think it's as much as popular as Brahms. It's really Tsigan roots.
Real
you
gypsy,
know?
Yes. And
I think so.
Well, when I say that, because, you know, they really were made for two pianos, but the orchestral version became much more popular.
Yeah, and
it's better.
It's
better.
Interesting
the two
to
pianos
hear.
Better.
No, the music from the orchestra is better. It's
The arrangement he has done after for orchestra is very interesting. And when we record, we use a lot of things are in the arrangement.
See, you put it in.
Yes.
It
changed.
Actually, I would even love like to be able, I wouldn't have done it for the record because it's classic, but almost to improvise in gypsy style, you know.
Now, do you both have that jazz training, or is it only Katia, Mario?
Only Katia.
Uh-huh. So she would improvise and you would just be, you'd look at her in awe, right? Okay. We're going to hear now one of the most popular works in the whole American repertory, perhaps the most played of all American works, and that's the Gershwin Rhapsody in Blue. But as we said of the concerto, we do not hear it every day in the two piano version, and it is a marvelous version, as both of you know. And here is the Rhapsody in Blue, Katia and Marielle Labèque, duo piano. Thank you. Rhapsody in Blue, of course. Katia and Marielle Labèque, sisters and duo pianists in that performance. And after these messages, I will continue talking with both of these French pianists. I'm back. Well, you just had to hear that all over again. I mean, what do you feel when you have to hear your own work? Do you say, oh, should I do this again someday if I only could do it differently or better, or is it just...
It depends. Sometimes I don't like to hear, because, mm-hmm. and sometimes I like, I don't know, because we change and...
But we all always like to play it, yeah, which is sure. totally different.
It's very interesting. That's different.
We never heard our record just when we are doing the record, but after, mm-hmm. I don't like that.
Sometimes much after, like 10 years after, 8 years after, you know, then you say, let's see.
Yeah. Everyone has such special feelings about hearing their own recordings. Some just can't sure. tolerate it. Some are amazed at how good it is when they thought it was bad.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
someone said, and this is interesting, I think it was Misha Dichter on a program mm-hmm. here, he said, when I listen to a recording, I have to be very careful in my judgment because mm-hmm. on the days that I feel pretty good about myself, everything sounds all right. Mm-hmm. But on the days I don't like myself or don't feel as good, it doesn't sound as good.
No, that's true. Sure. It's something Brendel taught us, for example, and it's very hard, is to recognize what is good or what is bad. Mm-hmm. Because we have mm-hmm. the tendency or to say it's all bad yes. or to say, oh, that's pretty good. Mm-hmm. And you know, that's the most difficult thing, to know exactly mm-hmm. what you're able to give in the music, what you're able to do, what's your... And to recognize it, but with, you know...
The most difficult for the concert, because when we are doing a record, we hear just after we're playing what we are doing. But after a concert, we don't know. Mm-hmm. And it's the most difficult to be able to know exactly what we've done.
Mm-hmm. So sometimes when you hear tape much after, you have to, you know, to be able to recognize the both sides. Mm-hmm. And that's, I think, the most difficult thing. But it's necessary, like, to grow up, to progress is necessary, because you have to know you, your playing, and what you're able to do mm-hmm. or not to do. That's important.
Mm-hmm. I'll ask you a few questions really not involved in music. You are both young musicians, and your career should be in front of you in many ways. It's starting with a great bang, although you've played for a long time. It takes a long time, doesn't it, to make a career?
Mm.
So difficult.
It's true. That's true.
Do you feel good about... You're traveling a great deal. Do you feel good about the world?
Yes.
You do. Is there an optimistic...
Yes, sometimes about the world, what's happening in the world, that's
what I mean.
Yes, I have a few questions, of course. But about traveling and playing, and that, I love it.
If you had children, would you want them to be musicians?
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. You
yes.
would?
Yeah. Hmm. Oh, yes, of course.
I mean, so many people answer no.
Music gave me everything. Yeah. Music gave me everything. Everything I have, then I have to give it.
Give
everything
it
I have to the music.
Mm-hmm. Now, do you want to continue recording and playing, or do you want to play mostly, or is the recording a sideline?
As long as we can have some control on the recording, mm-hmm. I want to try to make both. Both are necessary.
Mm-hmm.
Because recording are necessary, because some place you can't go to play and then get people to know you, and also to fix a certain period of your life or your work. Of, I think it's necessary, help you to progress.
Mm-hmm.
But playing, it's nothing like playing. It's nothing like the public. Some public has talent. Some public can really make you play better.
Hmm. So an audience is important to both
of
you.
Oh, yes. Mm-hmm. Very important.
They can stimulate you. Now, you are both interesting in that you want to play contemporary music. Did other people beside Berio ever write for you? Music for you?
We play a lot of Ligeti, the three piece for two piano.
How do you read that stuff?
We did it. We even taught it. I mean, it was an academy, summer academy.
Oh, so you
and,
both teach two pianos
and
also?
And Ligeti mm. asked us to come just to teach those pieces. And
fantastic.
It was a very beautiful experiment. Very
fantastic.
Beautiful.
Fantastic. Well, you have been delightful guests, and I thank you very much for being here. And I'll be looking forward to not only hearing you play, but to the new Brahms Hungarian Dance album.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.